there's only certain areas where everyone uses vehicles, diesel vehicles, and all diesel vehicles. Of course, making problems. You know, of course, not far from my house, the A41, which is one of the highest used roads on the list. So there's something that needs to be addressed throughout. And given the point that I made earlier, the International Business Park is in the neighbourhood of Wallasey. If it does take off, we will have more and more vehicles going through from the A41 into the M53 and going right through my ward.
If we can change, just trying to put Dave out of the misery. The leader of the council announced last year that the International Trade Centre, which was moved from Wirral Waters to Bromborough, was not going to go ahead at all because there was no investment, but you seem to be holding a camera for it.
Thank you, Chair. I'm not holding a camera for it at all. I'm saying it was originally covered because the star of the development in Wirral Waters, it died its death. Decided to move it forward, but it does take off, and we've got a problem.
There's no
plan
for that yet.
I think the answer to Chris's thing is we want to be both. We want to be connected to HS2 and we want to improve our local rail services. And it is very difficult to read a report like this when you're confronted by some very hard hitting local issues about the buses, stuff like that. It's hard to lift yourself out of this, you know, your local issues to what is the strategic view that the city region is taking. And I think we need to do. We need dramatic investments in public transport, like we've never seen before, because it is past itself, I think.
Thank you very much for your report. Those kind of big issues are kind of political policy issues, and I'm sort of expecting portfolio holders to be here at the Scrutiny Committee. This is my first meeting, and I'm not sure it's kind of normal practice, but sort of expect the lead political people to give reports and answer questions on all kinds of issues that we've covered tonight. And I just want to ask also, Councillor Blakeley, you said there's an underspend on some homeless fund, but if you provide the evidence for that, I think that's going to be important.
Yeah, with the others, it's just going to touch the housing trustee that provided it to them. 121,000.
I will make a comment because, as I say, on Mersey Travel, we are, in effect, have been acting as the host for the Real City Region. Many of these policy areas are still appointing people to develop them. They're not staffed up yet. So if there's a time lapse between money being issued and policies coming out, I think it's because there's still capacity building in many respects, not fully fledged. If that's fair to say, they're not fully fledged. We are filling these, you know, officers' roles. To develop these policies, but it's sort of been a slower start, I think, than the Manchester situation, and that, you know, it is, you know, no problem with headphones other than that's the way I am.
Definitely has been, so.
Okay, yeah, thanks, Jay. Just to come back, so there's no confusion. I'm not opposed to HS2. I think you're right, it should happen, but I don't think it should happen at the expense of the rest of the rail service across the country suffering. And I think if we've got billions to spend on the rail service, then we should be spending that to get our current rail service up to standard before we consider spending billions on another service. And Dave said, as he said, you know, West Coast Main Line is maybe at capacity. There's only one train an hour goes out of Liverpool. There's 3 an hour goes out of Manchester. You can increase capacity by making 2 an hour through Liverpool. It's not rocket science to double the amount of capacity just by doubling the amount of trains. Why should Manchester have 3 trains an hour to London and Liverpool get one? It's crazy. And yet, that's the way it is. And we should be lobbying for those improvements, just as I continue to fight the town of the station. I'm sure it's still on Jersey Saddle's list. I don't know how far down it is. But what started at 4 million in 2001 is now somewhere around 10 million. You know, so whether it'll ever happen, I don't know.
You have the opportunity to get
Christian,
you're back on the road, so
that's fine. No, I didn't.
Cycle stations,
you rebuilt it? You know, and, oh, it's actually not. Town bigger discussions. The other line we should be measuring on borderlands, basic interaction. We should be doing loads on that. It is chronic that we've got chronic rail service. It serves the northwest, and we're fighting to take 20 minutes off the train journey from Liverpool to London. And I think we can have both, but I think it's about priorities which can serve.
Thank you very much. The next thing is, it's my report as the city region on scrutiny. It's been very, very slow. Getting another report, I'm happy to report that we have a web programme. We've now got a huge workload, as you can see, and the first screening meeting was today on housing. Really interesting, so the notes from that meeting today are being written up. And once we receive the report, we say to the panel. And it was really interesting to read the comments and questions from people right across the region. I thought we enjoyed it. The next one. Going to do is on the 12th of December, which is EU funding post-Brexit, so that should be very, very interesting indeed, and especially what the impact of the city region is going to be, so I can update you on that. The one after that is one which I'm really keen on, is maybe not as high profile as that kind of thing. The effectiveness of the careers, education and advice activities. I don't know what goes on in terms of careers and finances. But you know, when we've got all this development going on, not only in the region, but especially in the world, I really do want more information, as I'm sure everybody else does, on how we're helping our younger people to choose careers which best suit their needs and ours as well. So, I'll update you on that. I won't bore you with the rest of them, I'll tell you as we go on. Okay. Thank you very much. So, the next one, quarter two, we're on plan performance.
Thank you, Chair. You've got in front of you, you've got the quarter ending September for this year for this scrutiny committee. You've got the report in front of you with the appended landscape form on tables as well. Again, interestingly, we've already touched on some of these items this evening and other items, and just a couple of things to flag up for me. One is around the jobs growth, which continues to show strong overall. Again, that really is a national picture in terms of more people into work, which is good news. Particularly, I was talking to the Chamber of Commerce this evening, and they were saying, I asked them about how things were, what's the mood of business, especially with Brexit, soft or hard. And they said, actually, rural businesses are very confident still, and are recruiting and are investing, which is really encouraging to hear. And the Chamber's role particularly is around those micro companies where you've got 9 employees or less, or SMEs, 250 employees or less, which often find, you know, colleagues on the round table often find that sometimes businesses will plateau and have issues around cash flow or markets or whatever, and will sail along and plateau. And the Chamber's job is to lift those companies out of those plateaus and get them to grow. And that can often be business support, it can be advice, it can be access to equity or cash or finance, it can be skills, it can be premises, a range of issues. We need to lift those companies to the next level and get them to grow. And back to my point previously about it'll be indigenous growth within the rural that gets us further on and waiting for someone wants to come in and drop in our lap. So it is about growing our indigenous companies. It is about promoting them around skills, access to finance, etc. And that will keep encouraging that jobs growth. Because I think increasingly 90% of our companies are micro companies or SMEs. And that's where your growth will come from. So the change is increasingly important there. So employment is rising, which is very positive. And again, a couple of areas where that's important. Visitor economy, again, is showing really strong signs, and you'll know as a council, the council's been investing heavily in the cultural events programme. Most of the visitor economy is a growing sector. You've seen it happen in other northern cities, Liverpool, Manchester, Newcastle, Leeds, where be promoting towns and cities as places to come and spend time, leisure time, weekend breaks, those sorts of things. Again, that's a really strong growth sector. And who knows, you know, if people can't fly in the future, the budget airline can fly to Brexit, we may be staying close to the home holidays, so we can always hope to stay here. But that's a really strong sector, one that we keep our focus on as well. They, for me, they are the headlines. There's a couple of other things I'd like to point out. The skills gaps. Again, talk at the Chamber and others, and we've talked about it this evening at Cllr. We do skills surveys, look at skills gaps. That's the gap between business requirements and what the education providers can provide. Again, that gap still exists, and Councillor Bird was talking about nerds and others. There's still a major piece of work to be done. Around particularly parental knowledge of careers and parental expectations, and also information bias and guidance in school that you just touched on that, so it's engaging in schools, which is no longer mandatory, it's discretionary now. And for me, that's a huge area where we need to focus on, perhaps one for a future session like this, in terms of how those needs of businesses are being met by the providers. Because it is an area where if we want to promote Indigenous growth on the Wirral, it's going to be a team effort from schools, from parents, from providers, from business to get to where we need to be. I think that requires a team effort, requires a working strategy that needs to get there. Because increasingly we can't rely on the hit and hope school of skills. You know, we provide it and hope business needs it. Actually, it's going to be much more targeted and focused than that. And for me, parental role is critical, particularly around growth sectors. Engineering, construction is one that always comes up as well. With our capital programme, construction skills, we're investing in a 10, 15, 30 year programme on waters on the growth cover. We can now go into schools and say to people, to parents, there's a 30 year construction pipeline here. You can train for a pipeline that is here now on the road, and you can have your career on the road. And that's a powerful message about the pupils and parents. So for me, that's an area of focus as well, which we perhaps some of the chair and the group can consider. There's a couple of things as well. We talked about carbon dioxide emissions. Clearly, clean air quality is a matter for us all, and for the city region in particular. That is dropping again as vehicles get cleaner. Again, we're looking to support mobile shifts, getting people onto public transport. And other ways of travelling again, we'd like to see that trend progress and increase. A point there about the serious, the people killed or seriously injured on our roads. I do know that Merseyside Police look at those numbers, they are very, very low. And I think they promised it in quarter three they'll have a much more figure which is much more accurate. I think they're having some issues with the data collection. So they've promised us figures in quarter three which hopefully reflect the current situation. So that really challenged through all that, but that's their headlines. So over to questions.
Thanks, Jim. This ties into what you were talking about as well there, Jim, as well, actually, with regards to school careers advice, etc. As someone who's been into schools and spoken to, well, young people in greater college about careers opportunities, they still think it's pretty awful careers advice that you get even, what, 25 years since I left school.
I suspected that one.
It's still not good, but just ask Brian. So on skills gaps in particular, are we still pushing apprenticeships with local employers? And also, are we tying in with schools to make sure that they understand the modern relevance of apprenticeships, and it isn't just about going to university, it isn't just about doing A-levels. And perhaps I'd like to see the opposition parties that actually recognise, well, one of the things I am actually proud of that we have done in government is actually putting money back into apprenticeships, because it was something that's been overlooked from numerous parties and governments of all colours for many, many years. The last major drive I had was an apprenticeship drive was under the major government, and that's when I got mine. So it is something that we are actually doing, although we'll recognise that there needs to be monitoring of the type of apprenticeships that are actually given. But it isn't scalably, it isn't cheaply, it isn't a way to, it's actually a way to earn while she learns. And it's an opportunity to develop into a career. So are we still actually working with schools? Do the schools, in your opinion, that you've worked with, as well, even understand, do you even try? Because in my opinion, my experience, that wasn't something that they were actually pushing. They were still very traditionally pushing A-levels in university.
Through you, Chair, yes, in response to the Councillor's question there, it is a very patchy picture in terms of schools and the quality of the careers in mentioned by some guidance. What I can say is that you'll know that it's been, you see it in the national press, of course, push and pull factors around apprenticeships. The push factor clearly student fees, student debt, stories in the press this week about the value of degrees and your starting salary when you're on the salary in the late 20s. And then the need to focus on STEM courses, for example, to maximise your salary. All those, they're the push factors pushing young people into other alternatives. And clearly, members will know that the rollout of the things like the apprenticeship levy, the apprenticeship programmes, broadening the focus of apprenticeships to all age of apprenticeships as well. I know this is a kind of a marmite subject, because some people see that as a dilution of the actual nature of apprenticeships, where it is about getting on the career ladder, it is about vocational work, it is about high quality, traditionally craftsperson or crafts apprenticeship. That's much broader now, but for me, we're already seeing signs, I'm now governor of the college, seeing signs that arrangement between the college and FE providers, schools and business, that's a very, very powerful alliance. And particularly for me, and I'll come back to the, apologies for this, the role of parents is crucial. About parents seeing there are alternatives and working with the schools, that there are alternatives to higher education. And it's not a second class option. Actually, it could be the first class option for individuals if you're academically inclined. And that kind of, for me, that certainty once you start, say, an apprenticeship by having proper support at parental level, school level, your provider, and the business community at the end of it can be a real powerful force for good in giving young people a proper start on a vocational career. For me, I'm a huge supporter for apprenticeships, done properly, done right. So I think that's the key, it's got to be done right. And the danger is that you'll see by seeing a much broader definition, you'll see a dilution of what this is about. So for me, I work with the college and providers to make sure, particularly here on the Wirral, that if you align apprenticeship to the work we have on here in the next 20, 30 years, that's a really powerful message to young people and parents and schools. There is work here, there's quality work here, there's investment here, you have to leave, and you can build a career here. And back to Councillor Bird's point about Laird particularly, some of the businesses are cyclical, that's the way they work. It's difficult to plan. And for parents to go into a cyclical, say their kids go into office, go into something that's cyclical, it's a hard message that one. So for me, the fact that if the council and its partners can contribute to long-term projects in the borough, that's a powerful message for young people and parents.
Chair, if I can just one second. I'm sorry, Chris. Yeah, it's on that topic again, and I do feel if anyone at Lidditz that might be on the threat at the minute, but as somebody who works in the card industry, which is probably one of the most cyclical industries that there are, on the pressures of the minute ourselves, but the whole point is there's 40,000 technology jobs that go begging every year in this country because we've got a skills gap, a massive skills gap. So the point is, whilst it is regrettable if those people find that the jobs are under threat, and I'm sure it won't all come to pass, but if it does, if you've got the right skills, there are jobs available for you. That's the whole point. That was my point about pushing apprenticeships. And that once you've got that under your belt, it's not something anyone can ever take away from you. You've got that forever.
Yeah, just first of all, make a few comments about apprenticeships. I mean, I have a very long memory of the situation during apprenticeships. And one is Margaret Thatcher destroying apprenticeships in the 1980s, a whole infrastructure. It's caused that. The problems that we have now all go back to those decisions made in the 1980s. So and the damage is caused over many years. In relation to just maybe a couple of comments about the as far as apprenticeships, and you mentioned the building industry. Now, the likelihood of someone who worked in the building industry for 20 years, the likelihood of someone working in the building industry, working locally over a period of 20 years, is highly unlikely in relation to slums. I remember I suffered 3 redundancies over a period of 20 years, the nature of the industry. So I think you have rose-tinted comments in relation to the building industry. But just to go back to the positives side, I wanted to pick up the importance of the tourism, the 426 million income in tourism. And that, I just want to highlight the importance of heritage and culture, our local heritage and culture, and how important it is for the Wirral, and also how important the Wirral gets its piece of the pie from the, for instance, the cruise lines coming. And who makes the decision where those sort of tourists go? And quite often it can be the likes of blue badge guys who are only interested in their specific area. So they're not sort of making the decisions, well, we're gonna go to the Wirral, they're interested in obviously making money. But the point I want to try to make is that we need to Wirral needs to stress its stuff from the point of view of making sure that Wirral is getting its fair share of visitors off these cruise ships and also from other areas. But as you say, it's a delight to see these figures increasing. And things like cycle routes down the likes of Eastern all the way through to sort of West Kirby, with all the heritage markers and things like that, all add to an interest for tourists to come to the area. So it's a very positive situation. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. Just on the data, smart transport, technology, infrastructure fit for the future. We're all planning the gates, but for third and fourth one now, if you look at the far right card, it says next data available in October 2018. There's no data in quarter one or quarter two. There's any particular reason the data is missing? If the data is supposed to be available in October?
Sorry, Councillor, which page is that now?
It's not page number, but it's 66, yeah, down the side.
No, about 66, yeah.
Yeah. And where it said page 66, up there in the fourth indicator. The quarter one, quarter two, both completely blank. But it says next in the file card, the next day is available October 2018.
Yes, the right chair, do you share? I think those two the date is it's October, that's correct, it should be there.
This should be there, yeah.
Thanks, Chair. On the same page, for years this committee has been concerned with the killed and seriously injured on the road, and our figures are going particularly well. Last business committee meeting, I mentioned how pleased it was at last, it was starting to feel better, and this quarter's even better. But I think you were saying that the figures are wrong, is that correct? So the good news story might be the good news that we've got.
To you, Chair, yes, I understand that baseline police have a class of issues about the data collection, and those numbers are going to be verifying in quarter three.
So they're on
there? Potentially, yes, they need to be corrected, yeah. I mean, when I first saw that, if you look at the year end last year, 127, the current profile is for a dramatic. I mean, we all hope they're right, but it's for a dramatic improvement. I queried that myself, and the response was it will be correctly in quarter three.
Because historically, we have 14 every quarter, so yeah. That does run
over.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, just really based on something that was picked up before, you said that a lot of the organisations that run the world are small to medium enterprises or micro businesses. So what are we doing to help those small businesses if we tend to ready to apply to some of the public sector contracts? Because in turn, that will create more employment for younger people and help to grow those businesses.
Through you, Chair, that's a really good point out that one. And Rose was sat at the end and she talked about work ongoing to look at how we get better on the likes of the Preston model, keeping spend in the area. And one of those issues is about getting local small companies better at tendering or better at competing for contracts, particularly public sector contracts, where, in my experience, it can be, like climbing a mountain to actually fill in the forms and understand how you do it. Where I worked previously, we did a number of things to support small businesses to access public contracts. We did teach-ins, we did seminars. We also gave a lot of feedback for companies who failed previously around how to get better at it. So there's lots of things that we can do. We can make our processes simpler. We can do lots of things to encourage local companies to apply. Because clearly, once they are successful and they get to understand how the system works, they can then grow on the back of those, often sometimes more secure contracts. They can grow, they can take on staff, they can invest. We're previously, back to the previous point, it's made them quite cyclical. The NHS is the big prize here, because clearly they spend a huge amount of money. NHS procurement, I won't go into that here, but it's often from a national footprint, like Yorkshire Purchasing, for example. I mean, when I worked previously, it was always my aim to try and get the NHS to procure more things locally. It's a bizarre thing about supermarkets where hospitals will buy toilet rolls, say, from 200 miles away in the factories down the road. I know that's a simple thing, and you can't often plan for that, but it just seems that there could be a better way of doing things. And again, it saves on carbon footprint as well.
Thank you, Chair. There's a point here that we've had an extension of European funding to help young people into work and training, which we have ways to work up to 2 years away. Are we looking at anything else to fill its place, or is there anything that we believe we can latch on to continue a good work process?
Okay, through you, Chair, that programme's working really well. And again, in common with the other things we talked about this evening, about getting young people into work in particular. Clearly, you all know that there's huge uncertainty around the future of funding when we leave the EU. The government has talked about a prosperity fund, which will kick in to replace all our funding. Again, we await further information on that. But certainly, in the post-Brexit world, be a real issue about labour supply and labour shortages, I'm sure, and demand for labour, given the employment rate is so healthy at the moment. It would make perfect sense for the government, through its prosperity fund, to introduce something which continues this programme, because it's worked really well, and driving down the young people's loss of employment, educational training figures, for example, actual apprenticeships, other routes into work. There's now a myriad of ways you can get young people into training and work that weren't there years ago. So I'd like to think, yes, the programme can continue, and I think it's up to us here on the Wirral arm, Merseyside, to lobby hard to say this is worthwhile to continue.
Thank you.
Okay. Can we read that report?
Agreed.
And now on to the work programme. What is what? The list. Are you happy with that? The individual
work
programme?
Yeah, sure. It's been mentioned for a while, just going up in the general set of meetings, we're looking to look for burning quite a while because of the money we're losing. We kept getting knocked back because of the review, waiting for the tourism review. I believe that's nearly finished now, particularly with the possible plans for selling the flock pavilion to a private concern. We've got a few members that work there already contacted us. I feel that needs to be pushed up the list as soon as we're able to do it.
Yeah,
it's not dated, it's just a concern. It's been on probably 2 years if you like it.
Maybe you can do that.
we were supposed to be responsible for the floor of the building, now we're taking that. That's all I've got.
I've got an answer.
I can't respond.
Okay.
Thank you, Chair. It's just on the when will be seeing the review of the car parking charges at the country box? When will we be seeing that?
The impact.
Yeah.
We had a discussion with Brian 2 weeks ago, and we're looking at having that in January.
Thank you.